Hey guys, I'm Lucas and welcome at kNews.space. I'm back at doing weekly launch coverage, so without further ado, what's on the plate for week 8? Well, only two rockets, with the first one being a Soyuz, which launches off Baikonur in Kazakhstan on February 21st. Up top are Egypt Set A and a secondary mission called Helios Wire 4. Latter belongs to a small communication constellation of CubeSats, which circle Earth, pick up a message and deliver it once they fly over the recipient. Digital package delivery taken literally. The destination is a low Earth orbit, but I'm not quite sure how exactly that one will look like. Judging by the launch site and the fact that this will replace Egypt Set 2, it will likely be similar to its 51.6 degrees, but please don't quote me on that. As mentioned, the point is to take pictures of Earth, which as usual includes a large variety of light spectra. Each spectrum of light makes distinct features visible, and I guess the most famous example for such a spectrum is infrared. It's by the way also what the pulleys use is to find people in the dark, as they glow like candles in infrared. If you take such IR images, you can basically track how warm the ground is. The more data you gather, the better you can understand how weather impacts the soil, and comparing many different areas to actual soil samples, you can start to make predictions of what the soil is made of in regions you have not yet probed. According to a 2011 paper, Egypt's plan is to further expand the urban areas into the deserts, and for that you of course need a good estimate of what the ground is made of. It would be very unfortunate to build a city on top of the rare, fertile ground where you could grow crops and whatnot. But of course, using infrared you can also track vehicular movements in the desert, so the satellite will have multiple purposes for civilian but also military applications. The second and last rocket to launch this week is a Falcon 9 the day after on February 22nd from Cape Canaveral at 1:45 UTC or in the evening on February 21st locally. On top is PSN-6, a communication satellite for Indonesia which shares the ride with two other payloads it carries. One is rather secret and belongs to the US Air Force, and the other is quite famously the Israeli moonlander Beresheet. It's the Hebrew word for Genesis, which in other words means in the beginning. The preliminary destination is a 60,000 km high supersynchronous orbit, which is where the Falcon's upper stage's job ends. From there, Beresheet is decoupled from the other pair to begin its 2-month journey to the moon. Yes, it will take 2 months. PSN-6 will meanwhile raise its orbit into a geosynchronous altitude where it will later also circularize and of course head to its spot over Indonesia. Once it reaches its final destination, it will separate the military payload, which will then also go on its own. It didn't get a lot of attention, but I believe this is the beginning, or Beresheet, of a new kind of launch vehicle. Companies using satellites to get other payloads from point A to point B in space rather than from Earth to space. If SSL expands on that, they could actually take away some of SpaceX revenue by offering ride shares to small sats rather than SpaceX themselves. Basically the same thing ships and containers do. A company pays for a container on a ship and whatever is inside is their business, not the ship owner's. But back to the future. By the mid of April, on the 11th, we'll then hopefully witness the first Israeli moon landing by SpaceIL. They released a great video of the full journey, so please feel free to check it out, I'll link it below. Beresheet is pretty lightweight and I'm actually surprised it has enough delta V for the entire mission. It has a mass of 600 kg, from which 2/3 are contributed by the propellant. If you put this into the rocket equation, using a hypergolic engine efficiency of around 250 seconds, you end up with 2700 meters per second delta V, which is pretty much the bare minimum, as they not only have to land, but first boost themselves up into a lunar transfer orbit. Raising the apogee from 60,000 kilometers to 384 takes about 400 meters per second, and landing on the moon takes another 2200. So that's 2600 meters per second without course corrections and the final vertical landing burn. There doesn't seem to be much margin, but the value I used for the engine specific impulse is just an estimation. Every second added results in the order of 10 meters per second more delta V, which is plenty on the moon. The lander was developed to win Google's XPRIZE, by the way, but like all other contestants, failed to make it in time. SpaceIL still continued and luckily managed to get enough funding. On board is a magnetometer, which is supposed to measure the moon's magnetic field, and an array of laser reflectors contributed by NASA's Goddard. Latter is similar to what the Apollo missions left on the moon as well. It will allow observatories to shoot a laser at the spacecraft sitting on the moon and get a strong reflection back. With this, one can for example measure the distance to the moon, which keeps changing, but also the composition of the particles in between. What I also want to highlight are the landing legs. The engine will shut down 5 meters above the ground and let the lander drop in freefall. To avoid bouncing back and possibly flip, it features a set of crush cores, which will, as the name suggests, crush to take away the energy on impact. If I understand correctly, one variant is used for the first hard impact and the other, which bends steel rods, is used to compensate for an uneven landing site, sort of like a one-way spring. For example, if one leg lands on a rock. Hopes are, the rock or whatever the slope they land on is, won't be too steep for it to flip over. They won't have control over the precise landing site, so there is some luck involved, but to give you a rough position, it will be somewhere at the Sea of Serenity, which is also where Apollo 17 and the Russian lander Lunik 21 landed. I'm not sure how close Beresheet will get to either of those, but sure is it will get a little more crowded over there, if, of course, nothing fails beforehand. The lander has a mission duration of only 2 days, mostly because it has no thermal management system, other than it being a giant heatsink. It is therefore expected to overheat rather quickly, but who knows. As the past has proven, sometimes crafts manage to survive for much longer than expected, like the Mars rover Opportunity. 90 days turned into more than 14 years. The last contact was established on June 10, 2018, and the rover was declared lost on February 13, 2019. Rest in peace. And now in the end also a big shout out to you my kNews boosters on Patreon. These people support me on a monthly basis, which currently ranges between $50 to $60. That's far from making a living, but I also don't see it as some kind of wage. For me, it's a great source of motivation to see people caring for the guy behind the videos. Thanks for your trust, guys. Okay, that shall conclude this video, and I hope to see you in the next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.